And what I'm actually going to do right now is go through a math example right now. Okay, we'll go through it from step by step, adding fractions with unlike denominators, and then we'll come back really fast and just see how math facts fit into the process, because it can be really interesting when you dig into one of these examples just how often math facts come up in a process like this, and then you see in a very concrete way the kind of barrier they can be for kids who don't have the level of automaticity that they need to be successful. Okay, with this particular crowd, I'm assuming I can go relatively quickly in the procedure, right? This is NCTM after all. We find lowest common denominator, rewrite the fractions, add them together, rewrite as mixed numbers, simplify, check our answer. Okay, so let's go through that real fast. What's the first thing we have to do? Class, we have to find a common denominator, right? And so what we're going to be looking for is multiples of the two denominators, and we have to find the common one, right? Okay, so what are the multiples of 8? I'm assuming that they pop into all of your heads, so there they are, right? And then we find the multiples of 6. More smiles, people recognize the multiples of 6, this is good. Okay, and now what's the next step? We have to find the lowest common multiple. Ah, it appears to be 24, very good. Okay, so we're gonna use 24 as our denominator. Now we have to find the corresponding numerator. Okay, it appears that 8 goes into 24 3 times. Multiply top and bottom by 3, we get 9 24ths, very good. Let us repeat the procedure for the other side, 20 24ths, no magic there. Let's add them together, 29 24ths, bada bing, bada boom. Okay. Now we come back real fast. Let's look at how math facts fit into that. Okay, we had the little procedure for finding the lowest common denominator. Now, as you recall, we actually looked at a whole bunch of math facts before we could find, I'm seeing some head nodding, before we found the lowest common denominator. But let's just look at the bare minimum. 3 to get to 8 times 3 and 4 to get to 6 times 4. Then we had to convert the fractions. Okay, we had to know 24 and 8. 8 goes into 24 3 times. Multiply it out, same thing to the other side. Then we had to add the fractions. Then we convert it to a mixed number. And leaving aside the fact that the kid has to know that 24 goes into 29 once, 14 or more math facts, just to add two fractions with unlike denominators. Okay, now think for a second what kind of barrier it is if the child doesn't have automaticity when you're trying to teach them this skill, which is novel to them at the time, right? It's complex. And it's the kind of thing that you need several parts of your brain, right? It's a new procedure. There's rules. You need to know where you are in the procedure, not get lost. And put yourself in the shoes of a child who doesn't have automaticity. And you're saying something like, okay, multiples of 8, let's find the common denominator. And they're, oh gosh, you know, just you've already lost them in multiples of 8, you know? So that's the challenge that we're dealing with. And it doesn't end, obviously, in elementary. You know, quite the opposite. You get up to something like this. There's, again, it's a novel, complicated procedure, right? Gathering like terms, distributed, you know, all of that. 10 math facts there. So let alone while you're trying to actually learn the mechanics of the skill, you go home and you have a practice set of 15 problems, each of which has 10 math facts. Good luck. It's not going to feel very good. You know, even if you get to the end tired, lots of work, probably quite a few mistakes if you don't have automaticity as well in your math facts. So how does that feel to the child? I make lots of errors. This is the kind of things that are going through their head. Math is hard. I'm sure these are all familiar statements to you. I don't like math. I'm not good at math. Very, very important stuff going on here, because they're forming their opinions about the world, right? They're children. And they're using the evidence around them to form their opinions about things. And they're trying to form an opinion about math and its learnability. And what they're probably seeing, because math fact fluency is a very public deficit if you don't have it, they're seeing that some kids seem to magically get it. And I'm not. Must be a talent. Must be magical. Not for me. I'll work through it, but not for me. You know, and so, you know, good luck interesting that kid in a STEM career when they get into high school, because this is something that starts early, and it's going to be, you know, it's going to affect their performance there. It's going to affect their performance year and year after from that point onwards. In terms of research that looks at the broader impact of math fact fluency, I bring this up because, you know, there's a commonsensical link that we could make here that, well, if I don't have math fact fluency, if I don't have automaticity, obviously it's going to impact something like multi-digit addition and subtraction, because that really involves math facts. Got a bunch of people who have recently looked at fact retrieval speed. It's called mental chronometry. And all it means is that you're using how quickly a child retrieves the math fact as an index of the strength of association of how well they've automatized and then if they're using retrieval in the first place. So it's a great way to look at, okay, does fact retrieval speed predict your performance in something like multi-digit computation? Well, guess what? It also predicts things like performance on word problems. It also predicted, this was a study in 99 where they ran actually a whole bunch of studies, and they were looking at middle school and high school performance, predicts performance on standardized tests, a whole range of items. Things like reasoning, data interpretation, conceptual understanding. And then a longitudinal study of 300 students from kindergarten to grade 3 showed that retrieval of arithmetic facts from long-term memory predicted your membership in high or low achieving groups in grade 3. So something that starts very, very early, and it has its tendrils sort of everywhere.